What's up, internet? Welcome to this video talking about how you can use Windows as an awesome development box. My name is Craig Loewen.
And I'm Kayla Cinnamon.
Today we're going to be talking to you about how you can use Windows Terminal, the Windows Subsystem for Linux, VS Code, GitHub Actions, and of course Azure to develop amazing applications.
So the first thing we're going to dive right into is Windows Terminal, because where else would you start for creating an application? The command line. So we've created a new command line experience here on Windows, and it's the new Windows Terminal. So you can get the Windows Terminal from Microsoft Store today. We have it in preview, or you can even get it on GitHub because we have it completely open sourced, and you can download the package from there. So what's really great in Windows Terminal is that it's a whole new UI, as well as performance improvement for the command line experience. So here we have a very beautiful acrylic background that you can control the opacity of by just doing control shift and scroll and tweaking it to your liking. And we also have a fully tabbed interface, so you can run different shells or Linux distributions side by side within the same window, and they can all be running separately to complete whatever tasks you like. So here we've just opened WSL, which is running an Ubuntu distro, and we are showing off things like emojis. So the terminal actually has a new text renderer that is able to render Unicode characters, which includes emojis as well as programming ligatures. So if you're not sure what a programming ligature is, it's when different symbols are typed in sequence one after the other, and they merge together to form a new symbol. So here we have double equals, which will merge together into a longer equal sign, and then another example would be triple equals, which is just three lines stacked on top of each other. So it makes your programming code look a lot more fluent and easy to read. And from there, I'll throw it over to Craig, who could talk more about what exactly WSL is.
Yeah, so what would be an awesome command line experience without an amazing shell to run behind it? Mm-hmm. And that is the Windows Subsystem for Linux, which we commonly refer to as WSL. So if you haven't heard of it, it is a way for you to run your Linux applications directly on Windows. So that means you can download your favorite distro like Ubuntu, Debian, OpenSUSE, or even some custom distros that were made specifically for WSL like Penguin. And you can install them, and when you run them, you get access to a bash shell right away. From there, you can do things like sudo apt update, sudo apt install, and run your favorite Linux tools and applications. But it goes beyond just a regular like dual booting or traditional VM experience, because you can do things like access your Windows files directly from your bash shell. So you can cd into your mount c drive and access your Windows files, ls from there, run Linux applications on it. And you can even run Windows executables directly from this bash shell as well. So here I'm running explorer.exe dot, and I'm opening up my C drive straight from my bash shell. And so that's the Windows Subsystem for Linux. We've just released a new version called WSL 2. It's available to Windows Insiders right now, and it allows you to have a full system call compatibility experience, as well as significantly faster file system performance. And so that means you can do more with it and it will run faster. And one of those experiences is using Docker. So here I can run the Docker daemon by running sudo slash etc slash init.d slash docker start. Start the Docker daemon, and then I can start up a Docker container. And that's just by running my regular Docker command. So here I can use all of my favorite Linux tools and Linux workspaces and my Linux workflows inside of my Windows machine, directly inside of the Windows terminal. So it feels exactly like it's the exact same machine. Mm-hmm. And that works really well with other Windows tools like VS Code. So if I go back to my Ubuntu distro, I can open up a project that I have in here, which is called my useful website. Mm. And if I run code dot in here, it opens up VS Code. And here it's using the VS Code remote extension. So actually the only thing that's running inside of Windows is the actual UI. Everything else is running directly in Linux. So that means my debugger, my interpreter for Python in this case, and any extensions that I might install that I need to access things like files or Linux runtimes are all running on the Linux machine. So if I hover over a file, you can see it has a Linux path on it. Mm-hmm. So we're actually running directly in Linux. And where that's really powerful is I can go open up my files, edit and access them, set breakpoints, and even run a debugger. So I'm going to start my debugger and start debugging my Python application, go and open up the new version of Edge, and access my website using localhost 5000. And from there, I hit my breakpoint, and you can see that the variable I set, which is my platform, is detecting Linux. So I can actually step through this look at all of these different variables that I've set, get the full debugging experience directly inside of Windows, mm-hmm. inside of VS Code, running on Linux. So we're getting, play the Inception music.
Yeah.
And that's really cool on the server side, but we actually also include tools that will help you debug things on the client side. Mm-hmm. So that's, you can go and select Launch Edge inside it, so you can basically set up your .VS Code preferences to have different debugging environments, and that includes attaching to an Edge window.
So what's nice about using the new Edge that has Chromium on top of it is that you have all the same developer tools that you're used to in previous browsers, as well as you're able to set different breakpoints that then can be hit inside VS Code, so you can kind of have your debug experience flow freely through both applications.
Wow, super useful.
Super useful.
If you want to use either or.
Yes.
So here we've actually found that here's the bug on our website.
We have a bug?
Yeah, we do, because obviously our website, it has a cat emoji as the icon.
Oh.
And we have a dog paw coming down. Mm. And so we've changed that now to the correct action of cat paw.
Oh, yes.
So we fixed our bug, and now we can take a look at committing that and pushing that up to our GitHub repo.
Yeah, so what's really cool about adding and pushing new code into GitHub is the new feature called GitHub Actions. So after we pushed into GitHub, a new tool comes into play here, which is GitHub Actions. So GitHub Actions takes place when something has happened on GitHub. So that could be a new issue's created, or if you push code or commit code or do a pull request or anything like that. And then GitHub Actions will start doing whatever you tell it to do. So for us, in our GitHub Actions, we've set up builds that happen whenever new code is pushed to the repository. So here we have the fix committed and it's pushed, and now these builds are running on different versions of Python. So you can see the different versions listed on the left, and it's running all of these builds one after the other, so you don't have to do it by hand. So what's happening here is that it's installing all the dependencies and also testing it, as well as running PyTests, which are your own custom tests within Python. So you can have a whole testing suite right here on GitHub that kicks off automatically once you push new code. So that's one very cool feature with GitHub Actions. And another feature of GitHub Actions is the workflows. So here you can have, once again, something kick off when an action happens on GitHub. So here we have the greetings workflow, which just sends a fun little message to someone when they've created their first issue on a new repository. So this is done through a YAML file inside the GitHub/workflows folder on our own website. And here it's just the code that shows, here's what's supposed to happen when a new issue is created by someone new for the first time.
So yeah, once we go over to the issues, take a look. I posted my first issue here, and we can see GitHub Actions response says, hey, welcome to the repo, first time poster.
So this is a fun example of how to use workflows, but we actually have a little more in-depth practical example for how workflows can be useful, and that is inside the Yarn repository. So what Yarn has done is that they've taken the GitHub Actions workflows and they've programmed it so that when someone creates a new issue with code inside of it, it'll kick off a GitHub action that will run the code on the latest build of whatever the application is. And then if it can reproduce the issue, it'll say you're good to go, this is actually reproducible. Otherwise, it'll say that this issue has been fixed in the latest version, which is super handy in terms of keeping your GitHub repository clean with very relevant issues still there.
So we can jump on back out of GitHub Actions now that we've pushed our commit and we verified that it built correctly using the new CI/CD pipeline. And we can take a look at basically pushing that up to our production environment. And we can do that all inside of VS Code as well. So I have the VS Code Azure extension on the side. I can click on that and you can see that I have a subscription here and I have a website, my useful website here. And I can right click and browse website, and here is our production environment. And you can see we still have the bug. And if we go back to VS Code, and you'll see a subcategory inside of our web app service plan called deployment slots. And so here we have a slot called staging, and that is a slot that is connected directly to our GitHub repo. So the changes that we've just pushed go directly to this slot. And so now if I go and open up the slot, you can see, hey, we have the actual bug fix running here. And so what's cool about these staging slots is we can send a portion of the traffic over to the slot to verify that it works for the majority of users. And then once that we're confident that this is a successful bug fix and won't cause any problems, all we need to do is right-click on it and go switch to production. And from there, it will take that bug fix, put it up to production, and make it work in our site for all of our users to enjoy. That's the end of our video. We hope you've enjoyed seeing how you can use the Windows Terminal to start developing your app and then actually running it and debugging it all inside of VS Code using the Windows Subsystem for Linux, deploying that using GitHub Actions with a lovely CI/CD pipeline, and at the end of the day, running that inside of Azure. If you want to learn more about any of the tools that we've listed, we have tons of links in the description below for you to go over. Thank you very much for tuning in.
Bye, everyone.